The following is a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club.
How about this, Cowboys?
Yeah! Go Cowboys!
Let's go, baby!
Are you ready for a break?
Yes.
Are you ready for a break?
Absolutely.
Ready for a break?
Yeah, and so much for that.
It's time for The Break on DallasCowboys.com.
We were on a break!
With Ambar Garcia, Brian Broaddus, Nick Harris, and Derek Eagleton.
Welcome back to another episode of The Break presented by LG. Today I am taking over the show. Derek is somewhere on the road or on the fly. I
Hook
think
him.
He took a, yeah, he's going to the game.
Playing hooky, if you will.
Yes, he's playing hooky. That's right. Good call.
So today we're going to handle the show. We got Nick and then Brian. And I wanted to start the show. Obviously, we're going to play some games, which, by the way, we're bringing back every Friday. I'll be bringing back a game presented by Yeti. So that's going to be fun. And then Brian has another game for us as well. And we're going to get into the game and all the shenanigans for the weekend. But to start off the show, we did just hear not too long ago, Jerry Jones, he was on the 105.3 The Fan. And basically the things that's surrounding and circulating around social media at the moment is just a very simple quote that he said. He said, "I won't be discussing anything at all about Dak's business or contract at this particular time." I think many of us believed or thought that the contract could potentially happen earlier this week. They got done CeeDee Lamb, and then we thought that soon after, Dak's contract would come along. So I just wanted to bring back the conversation and see where you think the Cowboys currently stand with this whole contract negotiation with Dak.
Yeah, you pair what Jerry said on The Fan this morning with what Stephen Jones said on San Antonio Sports Star yesterday, and they are being a lot more guarded about these negotiations right now. And if you call back to when other deals have gotten done, this is typically the kind of rhetoric that comes around right before that those deals do happen. So where there is smoke, is there fire? I still feel personally in my soul that this does not get done. Will I be wrong? Very, very highly likely. Who knows? I don't see why Dak Prescott would get this done right now unless he just doesn't want that burden overbearing throughout the entire season. But every time I get a notification, I'm looking at my phone. I mean, I am on high alert at this point. I think if a deal is not reached by Sunday, though, I think maybe we look towards the bye week. And then if a bye week deal is not done, then we're looking towards the offseason.
Yeah, I was trying to recall the 14 years of working in this organization, and the one thing that I took from Stephen Jones not saying anything is he doesn't want to do anything to harm maybe negotiations. This time it's very critical. Things you say in the media might be taken the wrong way, and so you have to be really careful of that. So when Stephen goes quiet, I usually feel like that he's got something close. Jerry going quiet, I think they've got something close here. So wouldn't be surprised if we all wake up on Sunday morning, a guy like Jay Glazer on Fox, hopefully somebody from DallasCowboys.com has the story going up, first that he signed. But I have a feeling it's going to happen, it's going to happen this weekend, if it's going to happen. And I guarantee it'll be some guy like Jay Glazer who has a relationship with the Joneses, has a relationship with Mike McCarthy. He'll be the first one. All of a sudden on Fox, well, boom, here's your news, and away we go. Nick, I do agree with what you've said, though, about Dak. If there's a reason, why carry it this far and not go into free agency and see, where you're at? He's always bet on himself. He's always had success that way. But if you're always interested in reading tea leaves, this is the way the Joneses kind of operate. They'll shut things down conversationally, in the media, and then you'll probably get your result. Either we got it done, or Dak decided that he's going to let this thing roll until March.
So the consensus is, you guys feeling that if it doesn't happen this weekend at some point, it will most likely not happen, even though he could potentially steal.
Dak did speak on that yesterday, and he said those two can continue working. I will continue working, and you know it's not necessarily a deadline. I'm calling it a soft deadline because, yes, they can still talk after that first week of the season starts. They can ramp up conversations during the bye week. But ultimately, at the end of the day, if you don't get something done before the season, you don't want to get back in the weeds of these conversations while the season is going on, while different dynamics are going on. There could be a lot of different nuances that happen during the season. I mean, who's to say that, you know, this team doesn't start off strong and then those conversations just completely go away? So in my eyes, yes, if it does not get done before Sunday, then we're looking towards free agency.
All right, well, we're gonna stay on our toes and keep looking at our phones for notifications.
I just, if it's gonna happen, I could say, you know, we always have these guys like the Schefters and Rappaport that break it. Jay Glazer, he's due for a bomb, and he's got friendship. I say,
what do you know? What do you know?
What do I know?
Yeah, what do you know over there, Brian?
Oh, I know connections of people.
Right. Okay.
And you know, Jay Glazer, what better to open up? You know, I think Fox has got the game tonight, right? Don't they have it?
They have Peacock tonight.
Peacock tonight. Okay, so Fox is gonna, you know, here we are, Tom Brady, National, all this kind of, you know, hoopla. This is going to be a Jay Glazer bomb. Get ready. It's going to be, you know, I'm just going to report here that Dak Prescott's under contract, you know, and that's what's going to happen. So I would be.
Well, I'll have my graphic ready for some of the Cowboys.
It's going to be a race. If it happens, it's going to be a race between Glazer, Schefter, and then Rappaport. I think if I had to handicap who has better insight,
I think it's Rapp.
Rappaport has really good insight, yeah. But I think he's got connections within. He's got the head coach, and he's also got the Joneses.
That's funny.
That's probably not good for me to like, but I'll point these things out because when these guys do report stuff, you believe it. Because I mean, it's not just, you know, some guys, gals might just throw stuff out there, and you're just kind of like, it's got no validity to it. You know, or where did they get this?
There's been a couple of those this week.
Yeah, there's been a couple of those where we've had to circle back. And you know, you guys have done a great job, though, Nick, and the media of like, and you don't want to bash on somebody else's report, but if it's not accurate, and you're like, wait a minute, and then you go to the source, say you go to Dak Prescott, and you say, hey, this is, you know, you guys have open locker room opportunities to go up to him and say, hey, wait a minute, hearing this, is this, because to me, it didn't seem like the right thing with Cowboys wanting a short term deal. Really?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Well, that Dak was going to be long-term
my
deal?
Next question.
No, wait.
What do you think is the main holdup here? The years, the money?
I think it's the years. And we'll see if Dallas, and before, Dallas has always wanted long. Of course you want long. Every team wants long. Dallas is trying to stagger these contracts. That's been a problem for them. Unfortunately, I mean, they draft well, their players play well, their players deserve contracts. And so when all of a sudden when you've got three contracts in a row that you're trying to navigate and you didn't stagger them, that's some bad luck along the way. But I just kind of feel like though that they need years. You need years to spread it out to maybe give you the opportunity to have that ability to say, okay, this contract this year, this contract next year, 3 years from now, this contract. You know, instead of when they come all together, then boy, that's a difficult way to have to deal. But it's part of the, and I don't think you could call it a curse, because if you draft well and you have top players at those positions, that's, you know, that's something you want to have.
I could see an avenue towards, you know, these two sides sitting down at the table and being able to figure out why it does make sense for both sides.
Yeah.
If you're the Cowboys' perspective, you're looking at it and you're saying, hey, we got a lot of guys we're going to have to pay here pretty soon.
Yeah.
And we have a lot of guys on expiring contracts as well. Would they rather be dealing with this Dak conversation right when free agency starts next year?
Right.
Or would they rather have that number already solidified in mind
right,
so that they can go into free agency and they can worry about DeMarcus Lawrence, Brandon Cooks, Osa Digizua, Jordan Lewis, Zach Martin if he wants to come back.
Right.
I think if they know what the Dak picture looks like at that time, then they could focus on bringing those guys back. And that's something that they could take to the negotiation table, even though it is something that they have to figure out. Yeah. They could bring that to Dak and be like, look, if you want the best case for these guys to still be around, the best case scenario is that this deal gets done now so that we have 6 months before we can figure out what to do and bring these guys
back. Yeah, this was something I think that we talked about. I don't know if we were doing shows. It might have been shows there in Oxnard, we kind of were, I would say, listen, I would bring Dak in and I'd say, listen, you're going to win. You're going to win this negotiations. You have all the leverage. We don't have a tag. We don't have a trade opportunity. We don't have a lot of things. You know, you're playing at a high level, second MVP. You're going to win, okay? How bad do you want to win? How bad do you – and I would have and it's probably – maybe it's possible, maybe it's not. But I would have brought him in and shown him a spreadsheet and said, listen, this is what our team would look like if you take this. This is what our team would look like if you took this. You know, and I'm not asking you to give us a break, but I'm just showing you what this potentially could look like if you want this number. And some quarterbacks would look at it and say, well, damn, I don't want to quarterback a team that's just a shell of itself. You know, I need blockers. I need receivers. You got your receivers signed up. You know, you've got a couple of your offensive linemen signed up. You got a couple of young offensive linemen you don't have to sign for a while. But I would point out that, like, yeah, you're going to win, but how bad do you want to win? And I mean, win the negotiations of that maybe, and it's our fault. Yeah, we've got all these deals we have to do. We admit it. We've got this. This is what we have to do. But I always
wonder how much of the sponsorships and commercials and things like that come into play when you're trying to negotiate, because that's not a certain guaranteed thing either, but it's a big thing when you're wearing the star on the helmet and you're the Dallas Cowboys quarterback.
I think that would be different if he was maybe going into his second contract.
I agree.
Going into his third, he's so established by this point, I don't think advertising is going to be a problem with him. Because if you look at it, if he goes to a new city, that's just more opportunities. I don't think that should be factored in as much.
I think the fact that he has got such a pristine personality, record, he's not one of these guys that you have to worry about him off the field stuff. You know, new dad, he's the kind of spokesman you want. You don't have to worry about him driving 120 miles an hour on the tollway and slamming into somebody or something like that.
That's what I'm saying.
He's pristine when you start to talk about ads, and that's always going to be something. Whether it's yogurt, Sleep Number beds, whatever he has to promote, he is going to do it, and people are going to enjoy it. Now, I'll disagree with you on one thing. Mm-hmm. Does marketing him as a Tampa Bay Buccaneer or New Orleans Saint have the same luster that a Dallas Cowboy would because of the fan base?
Yeah, probably not. But I'm saying those opportunities would probably still present themselves.
They'll have the opportunities, but it's not going to be...
For sure, but it'll be different because I've been in that world of, like, mm-hmm. you're doing modeling and commercial mm-hmm. and all of that. So it would be different. He will still be making money and getting contract and deals like that outside of that. But either way, that's a completely different than
very lucrative for him, though.
No, it is.
It's very lucrative.
But location, I think, does matter for sure when it comes to that kind of income in marketing and stuff like that.
Unless he went to the Jets, the Giants, or someplace like that, the Rams,
Vegas.
Vegas could be another one.
Vegas
Vegas could be absolutely. I mean, you look what Mark Davis has done with the Aces, the basketball team, his ladies' basketball team. Those ladies are given money to be the face of, you know, promoting the Las Vegas area. You know, their team has gone out and they're paying, you know. I think it does make a difference. So, like I say, him as a promoter for the New Orleans Saints is a lot different than, hi, I'm Dak Prescott, quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys. That, to me, I always remember Sean Payton tell me this. He goes, listen, Broadus, you know, when you coach this football team, they know your name in China, you know. There's not a lot of places that's the case. You know, this is a worldwide stage that you're on at this place.
Well, I can almost guarantee you if he did end up in a different place with a lower luster for advertising possibilities, which
he's
going to
make up
10,
with a money contract.
Fair, but 9 times out of 10, that's probably going to be the case whenever you leave Dallas. But he has an agent that is really good at finding those opportunities.
Oh, yeah. There's no question.
And Todd France will
really
be
good agent.
You can almost guarantee if Dak is like, okay, hey, if I sign this, you need to get to work with this company, that company. I want the discount double check. Like, let's have some fun over here.
Yep.
But I think all in all, I I was talking about this with Bobby Belt last night, actually, and just
You'll never get that time back.
I know it's tough. And I was trying to call a high school game, and we were just like exchanging texts, and I was like, third down. but anyway, I think there are a couple of things wanting to keep him in Dallas long term. Sure. I think it's the locker room. I think there are some guys in that locker room that he truly just wants to be able to win a ring with.
Yeah.
He mentioned yesterday in his press availability, he said if winning a Super Bowl anywhere else would not mean the same as winning it here. Mm-hmm. He said he wants to be the QB that wins it here. I think that's something that he wants to keep here for himself. And then three, he is established here. I mean, like you said, he's a new dad. He's got this a new place up in North Dallas. He's built the Dak yard. He has been established in this community over the course of the last 8 years. How difficult is it to uproot all of that? Not really that difficult, but at the end of the day, he'd have to be comfortable going into a new locker room, mm-hmm. taking over as a leadership in a new locker room. And like he said, winning it in a different place, it wouldn't be the same as winning it here. And how much does he truly believe that at the end of the day whenever the dollar bills are in front of him?
Well said.
We shall see. We're going to keep playing this waiting game and see if it actually happens before the free agency starts. Let's take our first break. When we come back, we're going to get into inactives for the game, and then we're going to get into what did I say your segment's called, Brian?
Tough Questions with Brian.
Tough Questions with Brian Broaddus.
Yeah. There we go.
After the break.
Todd thought it would be secure to jog in the cheetah savannah. Todd believed the big cat repellent he bought online was reliable. And now Todd is trying to be faster than this cheetah that can run 80 miles per hour. But the good news is Todd has AT&T 5G that is fast, reliable, and secure. And he learned the best thing to do is stop running and toss her the backpack with the beef stew. AT&T 5G. Fast, reliable, secure.
5G requires compatible plan and device. 5G may not be available in your area. See att.com/5G for you for details.
If you can't be at the stadium, there's no better way to watch your Cowboys than on an LG OLED Evo TV. That's because everything you see is more lifelike. Every play, every hit. I mean, you might as well be on the sidelines. That's how clear it is. It's all thanks to LG's legendary technology. Perfect black, over 8.3 million self-lit pixels. No one comes close. LG OLED Evo is the best TV in the game for a reason. See for yourself at lg.com/OLED Evo.
Don't put off getting your oil changed, Dallas. Take 5 Oil Change, a proud partner of the Cowboys, is faster than you think. There's no appointment needed and no waiting room. Yep, you heard that correctly. Take 5 is so fast, you don't even have to get out of your car. You can take advantage of Take 5's fast, friendly, and simple service at any of their locations across the Dallas area. And remember, at Take 5, you stay in your car because they're faster than you think. Take 5, the official oil change of the Dallas Cowboys.
If you shout, "How about them Cowboys?" you have that undeniable passion that's the heart of Cowboys Nation. And if you like to drink Dr. Pepper, you love the unique blend of its 23 flavors. Together, your one-of-a-kind fandom paired with the one-of-a-kind taste of a delicious ice-cold Dr. Pepper is the game day lineup that can't be beat. Better yet, gather your Cowboys and Dr. Pepper fan friends to watch the next game and crack open a delicious ice-cold Dr. Pepper for everyone. The wins will be even tastier. It's a pepper thing.
Life doesn't stop when the economy is uncertain. The market might not care you have a wedding to plan or a kid to put through school. And inflation doesn't know you've got a family to feed. But Bank of America does and is here to help. With digital tools to help you save and local experts nearby, you can keep life moving forward the way you need it to. Bank of America. What would you like the power to do? Learn more at bankofamerica.com. Bank of America N.A. Member FDIC. Equal credit opportunity lender.
LG OLED Evo is the best TV in the game, but don't take our word for it. Digital Trends said the LG OLED G4 has the best picture quality they have ever seen. See for yourself at lg.com/OLED Evo.
Thank you, Nick. Welcome back to the second segment presented by blockchain.com.
Yes. And a ding.
There we go. And the ding, 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 ding. Okay, so we're going to talk about the inactives for the game, or what we predict those are going to be. But before we start, looking at the practice report, the injury report, I did see Kalen Carson. He popped up on there. He was a full participant, but it's still something that you're like, whoa, hold on, what? He popped up with a knee injury, but again, full participant. What have you heard, Nick?
Yeah, so knee injury for Kalen Carson, like you said, full participant. We were able to see him in the locker room afterward, and he was walking around fine. He looked fine, and he actually said he was more worried about a finger that he was dealing with. He had kind of jammed a finger during practice, but it was not a concern by any means. And then we got into talking about the Browns. So he's ready to go on Sunday. He's talking about, you know, being able to have that opportunity to start in his rookie debut and take that forward. But yeah, it's something to keep an eye on, I think, going forward. And if you're looking at the depth of that cornerback room, maybe a couple of guys that are looking around saying, okay, I need to be ready to go. So,
well, everybody else on the list looks healthy other than John Stevens. We already talked about him yesterday. So what are you expecting the list of inactives to be? This is just more as a fun game, I guess, that we tend to do on Fridays ahead of the game. What's your list, Brian?
I went this way. I went Flournoy, Stevens because of the hamstring injury. Lance is your third quarterback. Well, let's go Wheat. Put Deuce Vaughn on the down list in this first game. So got Deuce Vaughn inactive. And now my final spot was either going to be Buddy Johnson or Mozzie Smith. And I'm going to go with, boy, this is going to kill everybody. I'm going to go with Mozzie Smith as the inactive.
Okay.
Am I doing right or am I doing wrong?
We won't know until Sunday. I'll tell you what.
Do you like my list?
Yeah, I do like your list. I think I'd go with Buddy instead of Mozzie.
Okay.
But I see your line of thinking there. The only thing is, I think Mozzie starts.
Do you really?
I do. I do. And I think
I see your line of thinking, but actually I think he's gonna start.
I think he starts. But I understand where you're coming from with that. Because I think Mozzie's gonna get the opportunity here early in the season on early downs.
Mm-hmm.
And Linval's gonna have to earn it a little bit. And I think he will.
All right.
Yeah.
I thought they would start Linval Joseph in this game. And, you know, with him and Phillips is the backup three, right?
Correct. Yeah.
So you're gonna go with Mozzie and Osa inside at the tackles, right? And then that would be, are you going to start, is Nealon going to start at right end?
Probably not. Probably not. That would be where DeMarcus Lawrence is in.
So you're going to play Lawrence at right end.
I'm sorry, DeMarcus Lawrence at left end, and then you're having Micah over there. Right.
Micah would play the right.
Yeah.
See, Micah was talking about that Zimmer, he's like, he asked Zimmer about, that six technique. That six technique is, that's the guy that plays on the outside eye of the tackle. And it sounded like that Micah was more interested in, like, listen, I'll play over there if I have to play. But he was also saying, though, he would like to play some inside technique, stand up, kind of play over the centers and the guards and things like that. And I didn't know how much of that six technique or that outside, that edge technique that he was going to have to play.
Yeah, I think that's valid. I think Nealon still does get quite a bit of reps in this game. I think if you're looking at Marshawn Nealon and you're looking at DeMarvian Overshown, I think those are two guys that are going to have very similar snap counts coming out of this week. And probably in, I would guess, like the 25 to 35 range.
I would imagine so as well. Because you got other guys that can play in there and like help them out and not put so much pressure on either of those two guys. But I do have a hard time. I agree with your list, Brian, but I have a hard time imagining that they would just completely sit Mozzie out.
Well, okay, what was Mozzie towards the end of training camp? It was like we had the allergy problem. We didn't play in the final game
or the second game.
Or the second game? Yeah, I mean, were they bubble wrapping him or was that just I'm saying it's legitimate stuff, likely. I just didn't get the vibe that he was going into the start of the season with a lot of momentum.
I agree with you 100%.
And so to me, if you're just doing this because Mozzie Smith was the first overall pick, or not first round pick.
Yeah, I know what
you
mean.
Not first overall pick, but your first round pick. Man, and you mentioned the word earn it. Linval Joseph has to earn it. And I'm sitting there like, well, did the starter earn it? Did the guy that we're talking about starting earn this?
I 100% agree with you. I'm not sure they do.
Okay, well, they never agree with me. The last time, I mean, seriously, I get text messages that tell me they hate me. So, I mean, it's okay.
I think one potential flip that we could see on your list there, I like your list top to bottom. I think one potential flip we could see is maybe Israel Mukwamu instead of Deuce Vaughn. I think that's potential. But
so
you guys
think Booth over Mukwamu?
I think
right?
he would want the outside depth more than the
inside depth,
more than the nickel depth.
See, the thing I worry about is Njoku, the tight end. How are you going to treat him in this game? The one thing I thought with Izzy's got length. Izzy's competitive. Izzy will tackle. You know, Booth is competitive too, and I understand the outside stuff with him. But I was a little bit more nervous about Booth when people were taking him vertically down the field and stuff like that. And that's the one thing that, if you look at the Browns, that they got a little bit better at was throwing that ball down the field that way.
Well, the beauty of Mike Zimmer defense, you probably have a linebacker that could step up for Njoku now. You got the Maris Luafau or the DeMarvian Overshown that could step for him with him in coverage.
Is there any chance they don't dress one of these safeties like this Wanye Thomas? And I'm sorry, I should have looked at Wanye Thomas, who's our personal protector on punt.
Yeah, he has been in the past. It's been a different guy every preseason game. It feels like it's been a different guy every punt.
That's what I was a little bit worried about right there.
Wanye has proven to be super valuable on special teams.
Yeah, I would think so too.
And with the way Bell played in the preseason, I'd be surprised if he's an inactive guy. I think they activate all four safeties. I think if you're looking at a DB, I'd be
go ahead and say Goodwin there and then get yourself in trouble.
I'd be looking at Mukwamu before I'd be looking at Booth.
Well, that is an area that they're going to have to, I mean, have a lot of guys to step in and help for sure. So let's switch it up, and now let's step into your little game that you have for us, Brian. It wasn't tough questions. It was more questions that made you think by Brian Broaddus.
Thank you very much, Amber. Appreciate that. Nick.
Uh-oh.
Last night we saw in the game that could have been a tie game at the end. Baltimore, you know, it came down to a toe touch. Mm-hmm. That could have been a kick the extra point, go to overtime. Same situation, Dallas-Cleveland. Dallas gets the ball, scores. Do you think Mike McCarthy goes for two in this game?
Do I think Mike McCarthy goes for two?
Mike McCarthy's got a shot. He's down seven, and he's got a shot to go for the win. Do you feel like that he's going for the win on the road in week one?
Does this also mean that the quarterback ran for 125 yards in that game?
anything you want to do to get this thing. But the question is, does Mike McCarthy go for two in that situation if it was his team to go for the win?
I think he's factoring in what's happened during the game. Like, does he have a play that can work from 3 yards out?
Or has his defense just been gassed? And you play in overtime and you're gonna give it up.
I'll tell you what, if it's that same exact situation, Mike McCarthy is the head coach of the Ravens in that situation, he's going for two. Okay, anybody would be going for two in that situation.
Because the quarterback
and the running back that you have.
Yeah.
And the red zone threats that you have, Isaiah Likely, Mark Andrews.
And how about the fact that we've been talking about all week how Cleveland's not very good in the red zone?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, that's an issue. They're really good on third down defense in the field, but you get them in the red zone, they give it up. So,
I mean, McCarthy, he's shown not to be afraid to go for two. He'll do that. He's done that before. They've tried, but it typically happens earlier on in the game. He's had this whole thing where he'd rather find out earlier rather than later. So with that being said, I mean, I can still see him making the decision to, but dang, I could, yeah. Yeah, I'll give it to him. I could see him doing it.
I think he kicks it. I do. I think he kicks it and plays for overtime. Safe. But there's always the rule, like when you're on the road, you go for the win, right?
Yeah.
And then that's like the coaches. But then all of a sudden you're thinking, oh, go for the win. And then the next thing you know, you see.
I guess it depends how confident you feel about your team.
Well, you've driven the ball. You know, he's probably thinking, well, if I can win the toss, then maybe I can get the ball. But everybody gets a shot here now.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, if you could go for two by kicking a 55-yard field goal, Brandon Aubrey would be out there for 55 yards
every single time. AG, another Mike McCarthy question. How aggressive do you think he'll be on fourth downs in these games? Remember, we've always kind of, with Mike, it's always like, God, why is he going for it here? And then they get in, you're like, oh, okay, good. You know, and then, you know, just how aggressive do you think he'll be in week one with his fourth down calls?
I mean, there's so many different factors here that I'm trying to think of. I would expect him to be very aggressive mm-hmm. and like try to set the tone and go in, like, because again, we talk about the pressure around yeah. this year. You have to, that starts week one.
Right.
So I can imagine him just being very aggressive with every single play and going for it. And hopefully we can establish the running game and that can come into a big play there. And these running backs can help and make you feel more confident when making those decisions. So I would say he starts off trying to be very aggressive.
Nick.
18th, the Cowboys were in fourth down conversions.
How many did they have? They had to be one of the top teams with that, weren't they?
So they had 23 attempts. Yeah. Like I said, 18th in the 18th in the NFL. This is just a horrible list I'm looking at right here. We'll come back to this. I think again it's somewhere in the middle of the pack because I feel like there were times last year where they were around the middle of the field and it was fourth and three and they're kicking it and I'm like, what are we doing? You know, there's an opportunity here.
That's where I think I'm like, you have, what are we doing now? Now it's either you win or lose a type of situation, so just freaking go for it.
It's a flip of a coin sometimes, I feel
Nick, I got another question for you.
Throw it at me.
Are you worried about the crowd being a problem in this game?
Yeah, absolutely. I think just the environment overall. You're going to get that lake wind. It's an outdoor game.
Ooh,
wind. It's on grass. Yeah. This is a different environment. I think the dog pound is a little bit more amped going into this year than they have been in recent years for obvious reasons. And they have a healthy, somewhat quarterback, and they're getting a somewhat healthy running back in a few weeks. There's a lot of excitement around Cleveland. I think this is going to be a pretty big crowd. I think it's going to be probably one of the bigger home dominant crowds that they see all season. I mean, you'll see Pittsburgh in a few weeks. That'll obviously be a big challenge in its own right. But other than that, most road environments that this team goes and plays in, you see a lot of Cowboys.
A lot of Cowboys. They're not going to give up their tickets.
I don't think that's going to be the case here in Cleveland. I don't think so.
AG, crowd going to be a problem for this one?
I'm not one to worry a whole lot about crowds, to be honest. That's not something that I take a lot into consideration, even though it's very, very important. But I will tell you this, all week, they've been practicing. When they've been practicing out here, you hear the speakers, they're playing, they're practicing with very, very loud noise that they turn all the way up. Mm-hmm. So they're training for it and preparing for this type of environment. And to me, I mean, when you're playing, this is just part of the game. You're a professional, and this is just one thing that, yes, it could potentially be a factor, but I'm not too worried about it.
Final question here for you. I'll start with you again, AG. If you were to win the toss, do you take the ball or do you play defense? You win the opening toss. You get to call it. You call heads. You win. You're playing defense, you're going offense.
I play defense. I think one big key to this game for me is for the defense to start right off the bat putting pressure on Deshaun Watson. So you put in that pressure, make him be on his toes, and then also in the second half, your offense, you get the ball and you get going. So I think it's, for me, set the tone on defense and then come back second half and you got the ball with the offense.
I feel the same way. Yeah, I'm taking defense.
Any reason why?
Same reasons here.
Same reason.
Yeah. Also, I want to be able to get the ball coming out of the second half. And this is going to be a rock fight, like I said, of a game. Yeah. I want to be able to have offensive momentum going into the second half rather than starting out the game.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate that.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Brian. Thank
I thought
you
a little bit. I had to think a little bit. A
little bit.
We had us thinking. Yeah. All right, well, let's take our second break. And then when we come back, I have another game for you guys. Let's flip the ball, Brian. And I got you answering some questions, too, after the break.
It's the official men's skincare brand of the Dallas Cowboys, Jack Black. And right now, Cowboys fans can get 15% off their $75 order. Plus, because every deal needs a playmaker, your order will include a free 5-piece skincare set and free shipping. The Jack Black Playmaker is four of Jack's favorites and a full-sized intense therapy lip balm. Make a play for the playmaker at getjackblack.com/cowboys with the code CowboysVIP. That's getjackblack.com/cowboys with the code CowboysVIP.
They say champions are remembered, but legends are never forgotten. United Ag and Turf offers a winning lineup of John Deere equipment built to tackle any challenge on and off the field. Legendary John Deere tractors, combines, residential mowers, commercial mowers, compact construction equipment, Gator utility vehicles, and a full line of golf and sports turf equipment. United Ag and Turf, the official Ag and Turf equipment supplier of the Dallas Cowboys. Visit UnitedAgandTurf.com to find a location near you.
If you can't be at the stadium, there's no better way to watch your Cowboys than on an LG OLED Evo TV. That's because everything you see is more lifelike. Every play, every hit. I mean, you might as well be on the sidelines. That's how clear it is. It's all thanks to LG's legendary technology. Perfect black, over 8.3 million self-lit pixels, no one comes close. LG OLED Evo is the best TV in the game for a reason. See for yourself at lg.com/OLED Evo.
From the field to the festivities, Lucchese embodies the essence of luxury and tradition. Handcrafted with meticulous precision, each pair offers unmatched comfort and style. Stand tall while you're tailgating or cheering in the stands with the Dallas Cowboys Collection by Lucchese. Shop the collection today at the Lucchese store at the Star in Frisco or online at lucchese.com. Lucchese, the official boot of the Dallas Cowboys and Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders.
Todd thought it would be secure to jog in the cheetah savannah. Todd believed the big cat repellent he bought online was reliable. And now, Todd is trying to be faster than this cheetah that can run 80 miles per hour. But the good news is, Todd has AT&T 5G that is fast, reliable, and secure. And he learned the best thing to do is stop running and toss her the backpack with the beef stew. AT&T 5G. Fast, reliable, secure.
5G requires compatible plan and device. 5G may not be available in your area. See att.com/5G for you for details.
Back to the break.
Go, Amber. AT&T, connecting changes everything.
There you go. Perfect. All right, and we have a new sponsor. Wow, so many sponsors. Look, man, I'm telling you, you work for the Cowboys, you got all the sponsors. That's what
this
Dad
is really
needs
good.
To say
here. They're all really good sponsors, but this is one of my favorite sponsors.
Yes, we got Yeti. This Damn. Segment, Yeti's Game Day, filling the blank questions. And by the way, Yeti has a bunch of different designs. You can find it at Cowboys Pro Shop. So this is my favorite one. But they have a bunch of other
options.
They
make great stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Really good stuff.
All right, guys. We got the game. Fill in the blank type of questions. So bear with me. We'll try to go slow so it doesn't get too confusing. The first one. The biggest factor influencing the game's outcome will be?
The trenches. I the trench work on both sides of the ball. This game is going to be won at the line of scrimmage.
I'll be different. Quarterback play.
Okay.
Because one is clearly better than the other, and you have to, that guy has to be. They have to win that battle right there. Because the trench thing is going to be, it's going to be tough.
Yeah.
That is going to be tough. Your quarterback is one of the best when it becomes tough, when it's trench warfare. Their quarterback isn't. And it can't be both quarterbacks play even when pressure happens. Dak has clearly got to be that guy. But I'm going to say the quarterback, but I do really think he's absolutely right about what's going to happen on this offense and defensive lines for both teams.
Well, both things are
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
The most anticipated moment of this game will be when?
The first third down for Dallas on offense. Because that's going to be potentially when you're going to have to see how they're going to handle Myles Garrett here. You know, that's what everybody's looking at. Is it going to be a chip? Is it going to be a space? Is it going to be a one-on-one? All eyes are going to be. We talked about this in the breakdown. Early downs, you're going to get a lot of man coverage from these guys. So on third down, they play a lot more zone. That means more opportunity, a little bit more separation. Can you protect? Dak get the ball out? We talk about the pressure he's facing. He's good against the pressure. But that first third down of the game when it turns into it's a third and, say, seven, all eyes are going to be.
What kind of day are we going to have here?
All eyes are going to be on 95
yeah.
for the Cleveland Browns, and then all eyes are going to be on number 60 for the Dallas Cowboys if that's mm-hmm. the matchup you get.
When Brandon Aubrey trots out for a 70-yarder. No, I think it's going to be when that first deep ball is heading towards Amari Cooper's way. Mm-hmm. I think I listened this morning to Amari Cooper's availability from yesterday, and he spent a lot of time respecting Dak, respecting Trayvon, mm-hmm. respecting Micah, but you can hear in the tone of his voice he's ready for this game. He wants to make an impact in this game. So when that first deep ball is heading Amari Cooper's way, and let's say it's on Trayvon Diggs, that's going to be a highly anticipated moment for me.
One surprising element of this matchup might be...
Huh, you got something here, Brian?
One surprising element might be Dallas. We talk so much about the Browns defense. Dallas has got the better linebackers in this game.
Yeah.
I feel like, you know, Cora Moore is a really good player. And you know, to me, if running the ball for Dallas is going to be there successful, they're going to have to block Cora Moore. He's the one guy that will make the tackle. So, mm-hmm. But I feel like the surprising, you talk defense for the Browns. Dallas has got the better, they might not have the better secondary, but they've got the better linebackers, I feel like, in this game. You know, Micah, you could put him at linebacker, but I mean, he's really an edge. But I feel like that Dallas has got the type of linebackers that can play well in this game. So I think that's a surprising, I think a lot of people aren't, I don't think people are giving him enough credit at linebacker for this game.
Too. Yeah, I'm going to piggyback off of a point you made yesterday, AG. Kevontae Turpin. I think there's an opportunity to really get him involved in the offense this week. And if there is not any momentum that is being generated in the running game early on, they will need to get creative in the running game. Mm-hmm. And Kevontae Turpin, I think, is the first guy you look at. So Kevontae Turpin, I think he maybe has one or two plays that – will be big juice generators for this offense.
Good game.
In terms of game strategy, the Cowboys will most likely focus on...
They've got to focus...
Miles Garrett. That's what I just keep coming back to here. They are going to always know where 95 is on the field.
That's like a given.
Because it's the reigning defensive player of the year. But on that same token, as you mentioned earlier in the week, and I agree with, you're going to see him on both sides of the ball.
Right.
Where do you help? Where do you slide protection? And I think it's if you're focusing on Miles Garrett, then it allows you to deal with that experience in the interior a little bit more isolated. But I think as long as you wash out Miles Garrett, I think you can win some one-on-one battles there in the middle.
The strategy part of it, could you say on your side with Parsons?
Absolutely.
You see, because to me, you've got similar players here. You've got two guys that both teams are looking at it like, okay, when we look at the final stats, and it might not, the stats might not tell the whole story, but how effective was Miles Garrett playing? Was he affecting the pocket? Was Parsons affecting the pocket? You know, and Dallas in this game has the better offensive line. The way it's currently configured right now with all the backups and all that having to play. So your hope is that Dallas's focus will be, okay, let's make sure that we take care of 95. But I think on the other side of that, the Browns have to be terrified. They have to be terrified. But the Browns have got some other guys too. Okwuemeru and Smith. They got some other – they might have better pass rushers than what Dallas has. But I don't think that their offensive line – I don't think that the Browns' offensive line they could be in some trouble with Dallas's rush too. You know, especially if Zimmer gets into a game where he's blitzing this thing up and he's attacking them with the linebackers and you know, with Micah and – the twist stunts and stuff. I mean, I was watching a bunch of tape on these guys that they have problem with some movement, and the Cowboys they'll find ways to move up front.
And now to finish off this segment, the standout player in this game will be.
I'm going Micah Parsons. I think he has a big game. I'm giving him multiple sacks. I think he's active in the run game too.
I have been saying
I think this is a game. For the team, but I think Micah has a couple of those. So I think Micah Parsons, that's the guy I'm looking at.
I got two, and you guys pick which one you want. I think Jake Ferguson could be huge in this game against this secondary group, against these safeties. Maybe their linebackers too. We'll see how much they play in coverage. I think CeeDee Lamb out of the blocks is going to be good. I do. And I know their corners are, you know, their corners don't give up much all, but this is a type of game where I think that Dak, CeeDee, I know they haven't had a lot of practice time together, but it's going to be like old hat for these two guys. They're going to get it going early in this game, and there's going to be some key plays that he's going to make and come up with some big plays. Dak's going to make some quality throws, and it's going to when you're in a game where Nick's talking about a rock fight, what's the one way to keep, you know, with the rock fight, it's tough, it's back and forth, that kind of thing. Big plays. When you're fighting for inches and all, big plays make a difference, especially a defense that's really, really good. If you can't move the ball on them by playing by inches. You got to play big play football if you can. And I think CeeDee Lamb, Ferguson, I think they make some big plays in this game.
All right, time for game day predictions. What do you got, Nick?
Yeah, I'm going to stick to the score that I had yesterday, 17-13 Cowboys. Like I said, rock fight of a game. I think it's going to be whatever defense can match the intensity a little bit more. But this game, what it boils down to is being won or lost in the trenches. I think whoever wins that battle on either side of the ball probably comes out with a 1-0 victory.
Dallas wins this one 23-16, and we might see some of our special teams being a factor as far as getting return yards. You know, a lot of teams, like last night, we saw them kicking the ball in the end zone, put the ball in the 30, let's go. But keep an eye on special teams. Special teams usually struggle early in the season. They don't quite have, you know, the right, because you got guys, you're playing in the preseason, you're playing a lot of different bodies to see if you could play. Now you got your starters playing this. And sometimes you have some mistakes. Sometimes you have some, you know, out of position guys trying to be hero. I like to see what Dallas can do. They're going to, I think they'll take advantage of maybe some punts. You know, especially if they get Cleveland a punt early in this game with Turp and those guys. Maybe they can flip the field on some field position, get some shorter fields. But Dallas 23, Cleveland 16.
Well, let's hope that's the outcome. I have the Cowboys winning 2017, but I'm not gonna lie. Part of me has a lot of hesitation because some of the things that I watched during those practices at training camp against the Rams, there were things that I saw that just made me raise an eyebrow, like, huh? I thought.
What's one or two?
Well, talk about the red zone area and some of those passes that Dak was throwing and not connecting there, where they just couldn't move the ball, whether it was rushing it or throwing it in the air. Again, very small little thing that we got to watch, and there were very good plays that they were able to execute as well. But it's just one of those things that you're like, we'll see. We haven't seen them yet in the preseason.
Does having CeeDee Lamb back probably help calm those concerns for you in the red zone?
Oh, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. So that's an added element for sure. And I'm with you guys and with Brian that he's been saying, I don't think he's going to miss a beat. Like, he's going to step in there and play like he's been here all along. But we will soon find out. Tonight, it is the Eagles versus Packers. Happening in Brazil.
Go Pack Go.
Yeah. Man, I'm not going to lie. I'm a little jealous. That would be fun to be playing in Brazil.
It's very interesting for all the reporters having to cover that game because Twitter is banned in Brazil.
And so, it is?
Yes. So all these reporters are having to get super creative about how to cover the game.
Wow. And, interesting.
Yeah,
I noticed Instagram isn't.
Yeah, I was about to say. I was like, bang. I think if it were me, I'd be like texting tweets to a friend, be like, and he's logged into my account, be like, all right, tweet this. All right, tweet that.
That's a great idea.
I'll pay you $20.
Yeah.
Great idea.
All right, well, there you have it, guys. Thank you so much for listening and tuning in for this live show. We'll be back next week on our still laughing
me.
At Brian.
That got me. That was good.
Yeah, he always has. Yep. For Nick Harris, Brian Broaddus, Chris Beam in the back, I'm Amber Garcia. This has been The Break on DallasCowboys.com radio.
This has been a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club.
How about this, Cowboys? Yeah!